With that, let me introduce our first speaker, David Novotny. David is a research scientist at Facebook AI Research in London. Before joining Facebook, David obtained his PhD from the University of Oxford, where he was a PhD student in the visual geometry group, jointly advised by Andrea Vidaudi and Jan Lachlus from Naver Labs Europe. David's research focuses on discovering representations of semantic and geometric structure of objects from images and videos, and recently has done lots of awesome work in unsupervised 3D reconstruction and novel use synthesis. And today, David will give a talk entitled Common Objects in 3D, which is also a project that which is being presented at this ICCV. David, please, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much. Can you see my slides, please?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much for a very nice introduction. As said before, my name is David, and this is essentially going to be a presentation about like culmination of a two-year-long effort in a dataset collection and a very hefty experimentation on unsupervised UV synthesis. So this work was essentially a work of a large team of people. So we were not only working with people in FAIR, but I'm also extremely happy for the collaboration with the University College in London, and this is essentially credits for all the people who were involved in this very large project. So throughout this work, we will be interested in the problem of learning the 3D shape from 2D images. So imagine that we have four images of a teddy bear here on the left, and essentially our goal here would be to reconstruct the geometry and appearance of the teddy bear, which is the main object in the center of the scene, such that we can then render it from novel viewpoints, which you can see here on the right of the slide. And so essentially having this kind of capability opens a lot of interesting applications ranging from augmented reality, where we can transport objects between different realities, automatic generation of models for 3D graphics, or maybe even visual virtual try-ons of clothes for any living beings which are around yourself. And so I would like to get slightly more specific about the actual machine learning task which we would be tackling here. So we would assume the category-specific 3D reconstruction, where as a training set, we have a bunch of images of an object category, for instance, a bunch of hydrants here on the left. And our goal would be essentially to obtain a machine learning model which is able to learn the generic structure of the object category in form of geometry and appearance, so that we can use these trained priors later in the few view reconstruction task, where we are given a small number of input views of a given object. And our goal is essentially to reconstruct the whole object only given this kind of partial observation. And so in this case, of course, the priors are needed in order to fill in the missing bits, which are not captured by the input views. And so, of course, this task has been tackled before. And what I'm doing here is that I'm plotting it on a graph where on the x-axis, we have the difficulty of the task of the prior work. And on the y-axis, we can see the amount of supervision which is needed in order to tackle the actual task. And so historically, the first approaches are appearing in the top left part of this slide, where we have been working on synthetic data, or the researchers have been working on synthetic data. Namely, this was the ShapeNet dataset, which provides us with the perfect 3D ground truth. It has been generated by expert graphic designers, but one of the biggest issues here is that, of course, this is a synthetic dataset. So whenever we deploy an algorithm trained on ShapeNet, we really don't know whether it's going to work in real life. Nevertheless, I think ShapeNet was a great contribution to the community, mostly because it gave us some kind of like a first proof of concept that this kind of unsupervised category specific 3D learning can actually work. And some of these works are cited here on the slide, and what you can see is that many of the authors are actually speaking during this workshop. Later, the community basically moved to the right side of this graph, where we have been learning only from real isolated views of object categories such as birds from common from CUB dataset or cars from Pascal VOC. And so in this case, the problem is extremely difficult because we cannot exploit any multi-view constraints between these individual isolated views. And so what the researchers essentially did is that they assumed funnel annotations either in form of semantic key points or a known category 3D template, or they assumed like a very strong constraints on the output of their reconstruction algorithms. So for instance, in case of the CUB birds, it is very common to assume that the bird is actually perfectly symmetric along that axis, which essentially goes through the center of the body of the bird. But probably the main message I want to deliver with this graph is the fact that this part in the middle of the whole graph is essentially quite unpopulated by methods. So we don't really have methods which would be working on real data. And at the same time, they would not be as difficult as just learning from the isolated use. And so this is essentially where we enter the field. So our main proposal throughout this presentation is going to be a novel dataset called Common Objects in 3D, which is a dataset of real views of object categories. But importantly, this dataset contains multiple views, the same instance of a given object category. So this way, the whole problem becomes much less challenging because we can enforce the multi-view consistency constraints between the individual views of the instances of the object category. And hopefully this way we will obtain much better results during the category-centric new view synthesis. And so this is just an overview of the dataset. You can see here on the left, the dataset is composed of a lot of videos of these individual instances of the object categories. And together with the videos, we released a bunch of 3D reconstructions which could be used in order to supervise your 3D reconstruction algorithms. And so since this is only an overview, I would like to give you a bit more details about this. So the dataset is a crowdsourced collection of object-centric video tubes. What this means is that we essentially ask Amazon Mechanical Turkers to put an object in front of themselves on a solid ground, take out a smartphone, which is a commonly owned accessory these days, and essentially take like a 360 video slowly rotating around the object such that we slowly scan the object from every single view. And later in the second stage, we would take those videos and we would automatically annotate them with a structure from motion algorithm, which would track the cameras. And it would also give us the 3D reconstruction, dense 3D reconstruction of the actual shape in the center of the scene. So this is the stage of the reconstruction right now. So by March 17th, which is the ICCV deadline, we collected 22K videos from 51 Microsoft COCO categories. I will speak about the reason why we selected 51 Microsoft COCO categories later. And of course, after the submission deadline, we also continued the collection. And at this point, the dataset is double the original size. So we have 46K videos at this point. And at the bottom, what you can see is the number of videos collected for every single category in the dataset. So on this slide, you can see examples of the collected videos. So on the left, you can see some videos of teddy bears. On the right, videos of hydrants. Next slide contains cups and benches. At first glance, it is quite obvious that these randomly selected videos actually contain very decent captures, where it seems that the Mechanical Turkers were actually quite diligent in sort of following our advice in how to capture the videos. So this was about the actual data set collection effort, and now I will talk about the reconstruction and the automatic annotation of the data set. So the reconstruction pipeline was a standard two-stage structured from motion reconstruction pipeline, where in the first stage, we would track the cameras in the individual videos. So here, what we would take is the video, we would chop it into 100 frames. We would pass this through CallMap, which is a very major structured from motion framework. And then essentially CallMap would track or annotate every single frame in the video with the camera extrinsics and intrinsics. Together with that, we would obtain a sparse point cloud of the scene. And so here are some statistics of this kind of reconstruction step. So we collected something like 100 frames for every single video, which in total gives us 1.5 million frames contained in the whole common objects in 3D dataset. The reconstruction time was roughly 30 minutes for a single video, which in total gives us 5 GPU years of reconstruction time. So you can see that indeed, it would be very hard to reconstruct the whole dataset or annotate the whole dataset with 3D ground truth if we didn't have at our disposal a lot of computational resources. So these are finally some nice examples of the camera tracking. So in the center of the scene or in the center of each group of videos, you can see the dense 3D reconstruction of the shape. I will speak a bit later about how we obtained that, but next to it, you can see the collected video. And orbiting around the extra 3D shape is this camera icon, which essentially follows the captured video, which is the camera tracking. And in those cases, you can see that the camera tracking was very successful. So these are a few more examples of the camera tracking for a few more instances per object categories. In this case, this is a bunch of reconstructed broccolis, hydrants, and motorcycles. You can see that we covered all possible object categories in terms of their size. In all those cases, you can see that the tracking is actually very successful. And yeah, so now I have been speaking about the sparse reconstruction. In the next part, I would like to speak about the reconstruction of the actual object in the center of the scene. So the dense reconstruction takes as input the sparse point cloud and a bunch of cameras extracted by Colmap. And this enters the multi-view stereo algorithm of Colmap, which essentially annotates every single frame with a depth map. And then after that, the depth map gets segmented with a pointer and segment. This is the reason why we selected the 51 Microsoft Google categories, because we can essentially reuse the pre-trained pointer and segmenter, which has been pre-trained on the categories from the Microsoft Coco. So without any additional pre-training, we can just use existing segmentation models in order to generate a nice dense reconstructions. More specifically, the dense reconstructions are then generated by unprojecting the individual segmented depth maps into the common word coordinate frame. So these are some examples of the dense reconstructions for multiple instances of an object category. An interesting observation here is that if you, for instance, look at the plans in the bottom of the slide, you can see that they have been quite successful, even in the case of this kind of object, which is a very, very complex geometry. So this is a quick conclusion about just the dataset collection part of this talk. So we have publicly released the dataset roughly 2 or 3 months ago. The best place to visit at this point is the GitHub page here on the Facebook research site. And it contains all the possible hyperlinks which you essentially need in order to access the dataset, download it. But also it contains a lot of tooling such as data loaders or evaluation scripts. So in the future, we would like to release the next version of the dataset, which will roughly have 2 times more objects, as I said already on the previous slides. And hopefully the new version will also have cleaner annotations. Furthermore, we would like to release a proper public benchmark, which will allow researchers essentially to evaluate their methods on a hidden test set. This way we can basically form a nice leaderboard of different research groups trying to outperform each other on the new view synthesis task. Okay, so this is the part about the collection on the dataset collection itself. In the next part, I would like to speak about how we actually use this dataset, large dataset, in order to learn category-specific 3D. Okay, so the first task which we were essentially considering was actually not doing any kind of category-specific learning. What we first wanted to check is whether the individual videos of the dataset are actually reconstructible just on their own without any kind of category-specific learning. So this is the standard overfitting task popularized by neural radiance fields or neural volumes, where we just have the single input video, and what we want to do is just reconstruct that single object. So a standard overfitting pipeline would work as follows. So we would have a bunch of training frames from the video here on the right. This is quite obviously a video of an apple. We would randomly sample an image during every training iteration. We would take the corresponding camera. We would shoot rays from the camera, which are sort of impaling the center of the scene, which contains the optimized 3D shape. And then we optimize the 3D shape such that if we render the whole shape into the camera, we end up with an image which actually matches the ground truth image, and we ensure this by minimizing the photometric loss between all the pixels. In this case, this is typically just an L2 distance between the colors of the pixels. Together with that, we also have the ground truth opacity masks coming from the pointer and render segmenter. So in this case, you can match the predicted or rendered opacity mask to the actual segmenter mask. All the benchmark baselines essentially follow this kind of learning pipeline, but they may mostly differ in the way how they represent the actual 3D shape, which is being optimized. And so in this case, we try to cover all the possible popular shape representations. We started from, of course, the famous opacity-based implicit functions such as NERF, or some distance field functions such as the IDR or even like learned train marchers implemented using SRN, which is the scene representation. Furthermore, we also optimized voxel grid neural volumes, some kind of mesh and point cloud based construct. So there was in total, I think, something around 13 baselines, which we actually tested on this task. Together with that, we endowed some of these baselines with the positional embedding trick, because the trick was actually not known when these baselines were released at first. So here we can see the quantitative performance on the new view synthesis task for the overfitting to the individual scenes. And quite unsurprisingly, it is obvious that NERV actually wins over all the other baselines. What we also observed is that the positional embedding doesn't really help the previous baselines. What we found out is that the positional embedding, in fact, makes the baselines overfit to the training views, which was not great to see. And then finally, an obvious observation here is that the individual implicit methods quite decisively outperform the mesh or point cloud-based methods, which is probably, again, quite expected given the surge of implicit-based methods in the recent years. So this is an evaluation of the new view synthesis depth accuracy. So in this case, again, NERV was winning absolutely over all the baselines, which shows that there seems to be a correlation between the performance of the reconstruction of the geometry and the reconstruction of the appearance. So this probably says that if we want to come up with a nice new view synthesis method, that method probably has to also understand the geometry of the scene very well. We also evaluated some kind of a trade-off between the accuracy of the generated colors and the speed of the rendering. In this case, narrow volumes were giving by far the best trade-off because they are roughly two orders of magnitude faster than NERV. So these are qualitative results. Finally, so we can see here that in the middle column, there are the narrow volumes, which give slightly more blurry results than NERV. But again, what has to be seen here is, or noted here, is that the narrow volumes render essentially takes 30 seconds, while the NERV render of this whole rotating teddy bear takes roughly 30 minutes. These are a few more qualitative examples. So you can see that the data set contains all possible levels of difficulty, starting from the apple here, where the shape is very simple, but the texture is actually quite hard to reconstruct. Then we have very hard examples corresponding to this kind of bonsai tree, which has a very complicated topology and texture at the same time. In all cases, it seems that NERV indeed improves a lot, but of course, in case of the bonsai, there is still a lot to improve. So after we have verified that for the overfitting, the data set is indeed suitable, in the next stage, we want to do the actual category-specific learning. And in this case, the idea was to take a bunch of videos of a given object category, and then we wanted to train a single model, which is able to reconstruct every single video in the training set without some kind of generalization to the actual test. So in this case, we were just testing whether the individual implicit function-based methods actually have enough capacity to represent the whole family of instances of a given 3D, of a given object category. And so here we focused on the implicit shape framework again, because in case of the overfitting task, this was giving the best performance. So this is just a quick overview of how the implicit shape learning works. Given a camera, we just shoot a ray through the scene, sample points along the ray. For every single point, we would evaluate the opacity function called F in this case, and the coloring function C. And then what we are doing with this is that we ray march over this set of predictions such that we generate the final color of the pixel. What is important to note here is that this, of course, cannot be used for representing multiple objects of a given object category, because the opacity and coloring functions are only conditioned on the 3D point itself, and they are not conditioned on anything else, which will allow us to change the form of the opacity field. And so in order to extend this implicit shape framework to like a multi-scene setup, we propose to do the simple thing, which has been, for instance, already presented here in the graph paper. We just append a latent code to the input 3D locations, which are coming into the implicit function and the coloring functions. And this latent code is essentially broadcasted across every single 3D location which comes into the functions. And by altering these latent codes, what happens is that we can actually alter the scene, which is being represented by the opacity and coloring fields. Now, how do we obtain these latent codes? We essentially do this through standard auto-decoding, where we attach to every single scene a prescribed latent code, which is then optimized with all the other parameters of the network of the object. So in this case, we are optimizing the weights of the coloring function and the opacity function. And together with that, we would treat the latent codes as three parameters of the learning, and we would optimize them with the individual weights. And this basically tests whether the opacity and coloring functions indeed have enough capacity in order to represent the whole structure of, in terms of the geometry and appearance of the whole object category. So I will immediately jump into qualitative results because they look quite nice. On the very right, you can see that SRN, the scene representation networks, probably were giving the best performance, which was quite surprising because we would have probably expected NeRF to give us the best performance. But I feel like the issue with NeRF is that the implicit function itself is not a very smooth mapping, which doesn't allow the function to converge well to this kind of like a very complicated representation of all the possible instances of a given object category. Whereas, for instance, in SRN, there are layer normalization layers, which tend to make the whole thing converge much faster. Again, the advantage of SRN in this case is that the rendering times are extremely quick. There are a few more examples, and you should bear in mind that although the reconstructions are quite blurry, we need to say that, for instance, the SRN is able to reconstruct not only this ball, but the same model is able to reconstruct 300 other balls in the training set. A few more examples. In this case, on the hydrant, it's quite obvious that the SRN indeed gives probably the best performance. And there are also very challenging examples, for instance, the Steady Bear, where you can see that the SRN tries to do something, but it still washes out a lot of details. So indeed, the dataset is very hard, very challenging. So we are happy that there is definitely space for a lot of improvement. Okay, so this is just a quantitative evaluation, which somehow shows that indeed the SRN gives the best performance compared to all the other methods. What we also observed that all the sign distance fields based methods were not working as well as the implicit function based ones. Again, my intuition here is that it is much harder learning problem to regress the distance of a point from a surface for every single instance of the given object category in the whole training set. And in terms of the reconstruction of the depth, I feel that the conclusions are the same as in case of the reconstruction of the color. In the case of the depth reconstruction, the SRN again wins. Okay, so in the final part of the talk, I would like to speak about this most challenging problem, which is essentially the field view reconstruction of the object categories. So as a training set, just recall that we have a bunch of videos of an object category, and our goal is to train a single machine learning model which learns the generic structure in terms of geometry and appearance of the object category such that we can later use it for field view reconstruction and test set where we have a small number of input views of an object, for instance, the yellow hydrant here on the right. And what we want to do is to fill in the missing bits of information using the priors learned at the training stage. And so again, we will be using the multi-scene implicit shape framework where we are broadcasting this latent sequence-specific latent code to every single 3D point. But what I would like to describe here is what is the issue with the standard naive solution to this kind of prediction of the latent code. So for us, the naive solution here is essentially the fact that we can take this input image, which is the one which is known, and we can just pass it through CNN, which generates the latent code. And then we can put that latent code into an implicit function, which then generates the field of opacities and colors. Now, what I will describe next is why this is a naive solution and why it's actually quite likely to fail. And at the core of the problem are the coordinate frame ambiguities in the structure from motion annotations, where if we, for instance, where we are essentially not in the ShapeNet realm anymore, and this means that if you look at all the reconstructions obtained by structure from motion, in the individual images, we will see that they're sort of floating around. They are not aligned both in terms of translation and also in terms of rotation. So In this case, we don't really have this additional supervision in form of semantic alignment of the 3D shapes. Now, why is this a problem? This is demonstrated on this simple example. So imagine that we have a bunch of images. We generate structure from motion reconstruction. Then we generate the same reconstruction, but with different random seeds. So we will end up with the same shape, but because of the innate ambiguities in structure from motion, we will end up with a reconstruction, which is related by an arbitrary similarity transformation. Now, if we look at the embedding, at the latent embeddings generated by the convolutional network, imagine that we embed this kind of image using the CNN. This will generate latent codes at one. And then a second image, which is exactly the same one as the first one, again using the same CNN. Of course, because we have embedded the same image using the same CNN, we end up with two latent codes which are exactly the same. But the contradiction here is that these two embeddings, which are the same, they have to represent different geometries, which is of course impossible because everything in the in this pipeline is completely deterministic. So this is a problem, and our solution to this problem was essentially published at CVPR 21, and it proposes a novel embedding called warp conditioned rate embedding, which works as follows. So imagine that we have a bunch of source views of a donut. Now, what we propose to do is essentially describe every single pixel in the source view with a hypercolumn descriptor, which is basically a dense deep descriptor. And then given a target view, we would just emit rays from this view. Along each of those rays, we would sample a bunch of 3D points, as it happens in classic graph pipeline. And then we would project those points into the individual source views. We would sample the features from the source views. This way, we'll end up with a bunch of features for every single 3D point. And then what we decide to do is essentially aggregate those source features for that given point using an angle-weighted average. So this will generate a point-specific feature, which is then passed through an MLP. If the video continues. Yes, which is then passed through an MLP, where the MLP essentially predicts for every single 3D point the color and the opacity, which is again remarched over using the emission absorption remarch. And so the reason why this works is the fact that this kind of projection transformation of the points along the ray into the individual source views is completely invariant to the ambiguities in the structure from motion reconstruction. So no matter how I rotate the whole set of cameras, I will always end up with the same projections, and this will give me essentially an opacity field and the coloring field, which is perfectly invariant to the ambiguities in the structure of motion. So this is just a quick quantitative comparison, which shows that if we endow NERF with our warp condition embeddings, indeed we outperform the naive baseline, which is here on the right. And here we can see some qualitative results of the new synthesis using the warp conditioned ray embeddings. What you can see is that in many cases, the reconstruction is quite sharp from the top of the donut. Of course, the problem is that the donut touches the ground with the bottom part, so we don't really have enough information to construct. Okay, so this was for the warp conditioned ray embeddings. And in the last part of the presentation, I would like to mostly speak about our main technical contribution of the Common Objects in 3D paper, which is called NERFormer, which is something like an efficient marriage between transformers and neural radiance fields. And so the whole work has been essentially motivated by the limitations in the warp condition NERF, which I've been describing on the previous slides. And the limitations are twofold. The first one is that the MLP, the NERF MLP, implicitly processes these individual points on the ray completely independently. So it cannot really deal with any kind of noise in those warp conditioned ray embeddings. And for any kind of noisy input which would produce, it would produce noisy output. The second limitation is that the aggregation function from the individual source views is actually hand engineered. So again, if there is some kind of noise in the source views, this kind of aggregation function would be very sensitive to that. And so we essentially propose to deal with both of these issues using the NERFormer architecture. So in order to deal with the first issue, which is the implicit MLP processing the individual points completely independently, we make the following observation. So if you look at the points along the ray, indeed what you can see is that these points are just a sequence of features. And as such, they essentially admit processing using some kind of sequence-to-sequence model. In this case, the sequence-to-sequence model is, of course, a transformer, because this is the most popular architecture which has been proven very successful in the recent years. So what we essentially propose to do is process this list of features with a transformer, generate colors and opacities for every single point, and then we would parse over this in order to generate the final render of the given pixel. The second issue of the hand-engineered aggregation function is dealt with in a similar fashion. So in this case, we make a similar observation where imagine that we have a point along a ray, then we project it into all the source views, we sample the source features. What we will end up with is a sequence of features. Again, in this case, the sequence is unordered, which is of course not a problem because the transformers can deal with this even completely effortlessly. So again, what we propose to do here is employ a transformer model, which would essentially learn to aggregate the features along the pooling dimension. And this way the transformer can learn to become invariant to the noisy features which are input to the sampling process. And so the transformer, as I said before, is essentially joint ray marcher and aggregator, where the ray marching and aggregating steps are executed using these transformer layers, which I have described on the previous slides. So imagine that we have a bunch of points on the ray. We sample all the possible features from all the possible source views, and this will give us this nice two-dimensional image grid, which along one side has the dimensionality of the feature pooling dimension, and the other side is of the size of the ray dimension. And then what we do is that we basically pass this two-dimensional feature grid first through the ray marching transformer, which attends to the ray dimension of the two-dimensional feature grid. After that, we swap the dimensionality of the attention, and then we only aggregate to the we only attend to the aggregation dimension or the feature pooling dimension of the two-dimensional feature. And so we process the feature grid like this with the transformer layers until we are happy. And in the end, we end up with a bunch of predictions of colors and opacities for the points along the rays. And in the end, what we do is that we basically barge over those using additional absorption. So this is a quantitative evaluation which shows that indeed the transformer performs the best out of the individual baselines which we compared. So this is just a small excerpt of the whole evaluation. Indeed, we evaluated against something like 14 baselines in total. And yeah, a small feature here is that it essentially took 8 GPU years of experimentation again. So we really made sure that we set the baselines correctly on the whole data. So these are some qualitative results on the new view synthesis evaluation, where you can see that indeed the transformer gives probably the best color reproduction accuracy. Of course, it's not as good as in case of the overfitting to the individual scenes, because these reconstructions are generated only a small number of node views of the objects which have never been seen before. A few more examples. And yeah, so this concludes the presentation. So just to quickly recapitulate, we have released a novel data set of object-centric videos for learning 3D object categories, which is called the Common Objects in 3D. The data set is bigger than alternatives, both in terms of the number of videos and object categories. It has been publicly released on the following GitHub page. So make sure to visit it, because it contains all the possible links which you need in order to use the data set, download it, and also evaluate on it. Together with that, we proposed a transformer, which is essentially a state-of-the-art method, which is able to reconstruct the individual 3D object categories simply just by observing the videos from the dataset. And so with that, I would like to conclude the presentation. Thanks for listening to me, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thanks so much, David. Awesome talk. We're exactly at time. So there are quite a few questions about the Code3D dataset on chat. They're technical about accessing data and processing. So I'm not going to read them, but please answer them offline. Maybe one thing I could cover is how are you thinking about future releases of Code3D, if you think of any, beyond just the next thing, which will have like twice more objects, but more broadly? How are you thinking about that?
I think like a nice next release would be about deformable objects and trying to like somehow capture them or make workers capture them. We're sort of like working on this right now, and we would be very happy if this gets materialized into actual next release.
Got it. Okay, thanks. There's one more question on chat. Could you go into more details about how you model sequence to sequence for point features in Terraformer?
Yeah, so basically the transformer is a standard, so these little layers are standard transformer encoded layers. Yes. These are standard transformer encoded layers, which, you know, just you can import from PyTorch. What else can I say here? Yeah. Basically, the 2D-dimensional feature grid is just a bunch of sampled features from the individual source views. The features are, again, hypercolumn features. So there is, again, one more layer of learning before we actually sample the individual features. What is important to note here is that we couldn't actually use the standard transformer approach, which would basically take this 2D feature grid and just like a flatten it into one list of features, which will be processed in the transformer. The main reason for that is that it would not just like fit in memory, so we had to split the attention into this remarching attention and the feature pooling dimension. There is one more detail which I omitted, which is basically that after we process the feature grid here in this part, we essentially have to somehow convert it into, let's say, one feature per point, and we do this by weighted average pooling. And then yeah, in the end, these average pool features get converted into a bunch of colors and opacities. And then we use this, the standard NeRF emission absorption remark.
Makes sense. Okay, in the interest of time, we need to move on to the next talk, but there are more questions on chat. Please answer them in writing. Thanks again for the great talk.
Thank you.